Okay.
Hello, everybody. My name is Charles Ayers, and I'm getting ready to do the Voices in the Wilderness. You know, and so we're sticking with the theme of the whole thing. You know, John the Baptist was the voice in the wilderness, and he was prophesied of by the prophet Isaiah, which is in Isaiah 40, verse 3. It says, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." And so we're keeping with that theme. There's no difference. There's no reason for me not to stick with the theme with the voice in the wilderness. You know, and so what I'm going to talk about today is the things that are going on in the world. And because I know everybody questions what is going on in the world and why is the world this way? What are the things that are happening in the world and why is the world this way? But I also want to go to Matthew. I want to go to Matthew verse 3, and it says, "In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord and make straight his path." See, so the Bible's always gonna clarify, and it's always going to confirm itself. And if you go over to Matthew 4, verse 17, so Matthew 4 talks about when Jesus was... when Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and then he was tempted of the devil. And then after he was tempted of the devil fled from him, and some angels came down and ministered to him. And in verse 17, it says, "From this time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So John the Baptist and Jesus both preached the very same message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So now let's get into what is going on in this world and why we see things the way that we see them. So if we go over to 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14, God is saying, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land." Okay? And so what God is saying that all the things that are going on in this world and people need to repent of the wickedness that is going on in their life. So what we're going to do now is we're going to get into some of these things that God says is wickedness and the things that we as people need to repent of, right? Because he says that we are his people because we are all made in the image of God. So if we go to Romans 1, 20, verse 24 to 32, it says, "Therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness in the flesh and the lust of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and worship and serve the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. God being the creator. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men leaving the natural use of women burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due." And right. And so what this is talking about sexual immorality. And let me keep going here real quick. "And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased or a reprobate mind." So that means he just allowed them to do what they wanted to do because they just kept doing it. No matter what he said, no matter how many times he asked them to repent or he forgave them, they continued to do what they wanted to do. So he just let them go ahead and do it. "To do these things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only to do the same, but also approve of those that do them." And so when we look at the things that's going on in this world today, you know, people are so approving of everything. You know, they're approving of all of the craziness that's going on in this world. You have people who are killing people, and they're getting on, you know, they're going on Facebook, and they're talking about it like it's nothing. And you have people that are getting gunned down in the streets, and everybody's just, they're just acting like it's just part of the way life is supposed to go. And that's not how it is supposed to be at all. God did not design man to be that way. God said it is not good for man, good that man should be alone. And he wasn't just talking about man and woman. He was talking about everybody together because we're supposed to help each other. That's how we're going to function, and that's how society is going to evolve and survive. So let's go over to 2 Corinthians 2 Corinthians 6:9-10. And it says, do you not know that the unrighteousness will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, right? So what God is saying is that these are all the things, these are all of the things that are causing this craziness that we see in the world. The problem is purely sin. It's sin is what is causing the problem in this world. So when you think about the word fornication means to have sex outside of marriage. God said that to not do that. That is a sin to have sex outside of marriage. That's why we have the things going on that's going on in this world where people don't even really know who they are anymore. It's because they're doing everything against what God has said, right? And that's even people that are in the church as well. They too don't really understand what it is God says. So we're going to go over here to 2 Timothy, verse 3. It's chapter 3. It says, But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, and from such people turn away. For of this sort, are those who creep in the household and make captives of gullible women, laden down with sin, led away with various lusts, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. We have sinned so long and been so misled by the devil that we pretty much don't even know what the truth is anymore. Everyone will say, well, I know God, and I love God, and God loves me. Well, over in 1 John, chapter 2, verse 3 and 5, it says, now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He who says, I know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whosoever keeps the word, truly the love of God is perfected in them. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked, right? And so if we know the word of God and we know to do the right thing, then we're always to do the right thing. We're always to do it. It doesn't matter what anybody else has to say about it. We're always to do the right thing because God said to always do the right thing. And so James 1:8 says that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So when you're double-minded, you really don't know what you're doing. One day you're walking with the Lord, the next day you're walking with the enemy. With the enemy being the devil. Because I was once told that you can't straddle the fence because the devil owns the fence. If you're not walking 100% with God, then you're walking 100% with the devil, right? And so if we go over to Jeremiah 17, right? Because we all say or have said at some time, well, you know, yes, I do bad things, but God knows my heart. Well, in Jeremiah 17, it says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doing. So God does know your heart. And the Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you want to know what kind of heart you have to listen to the things that come out of your mouth. You listen to the conversations that you have, because we're supposed to have pure conversations. And if our conversations aren't edifying under godliness, then we're not to have them, right? Now, mind you, this is not to condemn anyone, right? Because I'm no better than anybody else. But I know what God has shown me about the things that need to change in my life. So I feel that this entire world is all in the same place right now. And we all got things in our lives that we can do better. So now let's go over to Galatians 6, starting at verse 7. It says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man soweth, that he shall also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. So when you sow to your flesh, when you you live a street life and you do drugs, and then you have a drug overdose. See, you're sowing to your flesh, so you're reaping the corruption of your flesh, and you're committing the sin of sexual immorality. That's how you end up with sexually transmitted diseases. That's how all these things happen, because the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And people sometimes will say, well, God is merciful. Absolutely, he is merciful, but we're living in God's mercy right now. See, because God's mercy is what keeping us from receiving our punishment immediately, right? So now let's go to 1 Peter 5:8. Listen, we're gonna go through this thing, man. We're gonna get this thing understood. We're gonna get some understanding of what it is. First Peter five. It says, God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. And right, and so what this is we have to be humble. You know, the Bible says that God resists the proud. So when you go about bragging about the things that you do, that is very unpleasing to the Lord. The Lord is not pleased by that. He's not impressed by that. He says, that's sin. Because now you're beginning to exalt yourself as if you are God, or as if you're better than someone else. And that's not how God created things. That's not how he created us to be. Okay? So these are all the things that have this world in the position that it's in right now. You know, the Bible says that for the transgressions of the land, many are the princes thereof, but by a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof should be prolonged. So by the things that we do, there's a lot of people out there that are making money. People making money hand over fist right now. Everybody's looking good. Everybody got on designer this and got this car and that car. But it's because of the things that they're doing to get the money. They're willing to do anything in order to get this money, right? These are the transgressions of the land, but by a man of understanding and knowledge, that is a man that prays, that seeks the Lord and asks the Lord to forgive them and repents. Repentance means to turn from your wickedness. Repentance to turn from it and never go back to it. This is what the Lord is saying. By a man of understanding and knowledge, the state there should be for long. So this world could continue if the people would just repent. So now, here's the way out of this. Let's go to regular John, chapter 3. 3:16-18. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Jesus came to save the world. He didn't come to judge the world. He didn't come to condemn the world when he came. He came to save the world. Through him, the world will be saved. Okay, so let's go to John 14. John 14, verse 6. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No one comes to the Father except through me. So then Jesus is your life. Jesus is the way to heaven. There is no other way to heaven but Jesus. So in order for you to get to heaven, you have to repent and turn from your wicked ways. When Jesus and John the Baptist was preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, Jesus came. Jesus was coming. God was coming to this earth. And that's what John the Baptist was saying. He's saying the kingdom of heaven, God is on his way to the earth to show us how to live and to show us how to get right and show us how to get to heaven. That's why we are to repent, turn from our wicked ways, and do what Jesus says and live our lives according to the will of God and the way God wants us to live. Okay, so here's something right here that I found very interesting. And it's very powerful. It's very powerful. Okay, so here, this is in John 17, and Jesus is praying to the Father. Jesus is praying to the Father. He says, I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of this world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. So Jesus is telling the Father that all the men that you gave me all of the disciples, everyone that has received my name and believe in me and allow me to be the Lord of their life. I have told them everything that you told me to tell them, right? Now he says, verse 9 right here, here's a kicker. He says, I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
For they are yours and all are mine. Are yours and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. So Jesus said he's not praying for the world. He's praying for those that receive his name. He came and gave his life to save the world. The Bible says that no greater love is there than one who will lay down his life for his friend. And Jesus said that if you keep my commandments, he will call you his friend. So listen, everybody, it's time for us to really get things in order and get our lives in order with God. God doesn't want us to.
You have 30 seconds remaining.
So we have to pray. So right now, before I get off this phone, I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. Father, I ask that this word goes forth, Lord, and touches each and every person that you wanted to touch. Father, it said that your word will not return to us void. So we just thank you for it. Lord, we love you. We praise you. Give you all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.